All right, Magnus, are you rolling?
Yeah, I'm rolling now.
Okay, Slake in 3, 2, 1.
Tight. So tight.
All right.
Thank you.
Josh with Autonomous News Savannah, and I'm here with James, Nick, and Matt from Culture Vulture. We're going to do an interview.
All right.
So what are some of your influences?
A lot of jazz, a lot of stuff, a lot of like chord players. A little bit more try to compose my guitar stuff as like multiple individual lines. Like a lot of piano players.
I don't know, I listen to a lot of all sorts of different stuff all the time, and that kind of all just comes in and is used. I've had a long love affair with this sort of like Sigur Rós type stuff that's like really pretty big melodies that go over everything. I'm a huge fan of girl-fronted synth pop music. For whatever reason, it just resonates with me. I find myself singing lyrics about, like, you know, boys I'm in love with and stuff while I'm driving around. And this is just because the synth pop stuff.
What's the band? It was like, you came out of a lady.
Came out of a lady.
Oh, Rubble Bucket. Rubble Bucket's the shit. Yeah, we were having a whole thing with Rubble Bucket. Probably, there's probably a tune or two that has like a little bit of Rubble Bucket influence in it. But yeah, all sorts of stuff like that. And then, you know, obviously all that ska stuff in the background for horn playing wise. And then same thing, jazz.
I was a big fan of electronic music, kind of always have been, you know, since middle school. After that, I kind of got into math rock a lot, so like bands like Don Caballero, when I first heard that, it was just blowing me away. Like that drummer, Damon Che, oh man, he just kind of that ferocity he has when he's playing is, you know, pretty crazy. So I got really kind of into that. I wanted to sort of start a band like that in college, but no one wanted to play that sort of weird shit. And so, you know, it's a bunch of different things, really, but I'd say, you know, electronic things, really mathy, angular sort of music.
So you guys have all come from exceedingly varied backgrounds of music. I know you've done some classical and ska, and you're from an electronic background. How do you feel that those roles have influenced the group now?
They tell us what not to play in a lot of ways. Well, I mean, it's really all over the music as much as we try and avoid some of those things. It's, you know, I mean, the electronic elements of math music is previous experiences all over the place. It's got the pads. We do like sort of electronic-y build-ups from time to time,
which then kind of comes to a head with like that linear classical progression.
Right, and then all the chordal sort of, the actual music of it usually has pretty strong jazz roots, like in terms of like the, you know, whatever chords you're actually playing at any given time, or whatever chords James is playing at any given time.
So, how did you guys find each other?
Yeah, well, it was kind of a Craigslist hookup. Right?
Yeah.
it was back pages.
M for M.
Yeah.
For M.
Musician for musician.
The actual headline was like progressive blues.
Yeah.
Like, what's the actual, like.
Because there's really no good way to say
what
the plan was here. And then I had all the experience with James back in Wisconsin.
Yeah, we
did that, and then we went back to, we moved to New York and did a little folk project for a while. And then years went by, and moved down to Savannah, and we got Matt on Craigslist.
Wait, really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Best Craigslist find.
I got this dresser.
Awesome. Really? I was going to say, compared to all the furniture I've ever got, but you got a way better
dresser. Dude, I have
a
dresser made for
years. As a drummer?
Yeah.
That's fantastic. How much?
$40.
Jesus.
Okay, so when you guys moved down here, you eventually found the scene. What has been your experience with the Savannah music scene, DIY or the bar scene?
DIY seems really cool.
Yeah, people are crazy supportive, and it's pretty awesome how well people respond to the house shows. I mean, it's like where I'm originally from, that's not a thing. Like we don't have house shows anywhere near from. So it was all, you know, bar shows, and a lot of that was cover shows. And when I say a cover, I don't mean it cost money to get in. I mean that it was exclusively cover songs. So it's, you know, there's not a whole lot of that type of thing here.
Yeah, a lot of people come out. Yeah. Even more so when we were in New York City. Like, more people come out to shows here than in New York.
Yeah, I do find that people come out more. I've been in a lot of smaller, like, mid-sized Savannah sort of towns. And as far as, like, turnout, you know, this is probably one of the most supportive scenes I've been part of.
What do you appreciate the most about the Savannah music scene?
It's a lot of creative-minded people, a lot of like-minded individuals that I've had the pleasure of working with. Not even just in music, but there's plenty of really talented visual artists. Got to give props to the DIY venue people that put on the shows and the owners and everything. I mean, it's really a great scene, and it should continue to go even further.
Do you guys think anything should be done differently in the DIY scene in Savannah?
I guess I would like to see people support the touring bands a little bit more. Usually there's somebody passing around a bucket during the show, and it does it sucks to see those touring bands leaving it. It's like, okay, well, cool, we got, you know, one tank of gas, I guess. Like, everything else is gonna come out of our pocket now. So, but that's pretty much it. It's not like a huge criticism, because not everybody has money on their cash on them.
It works sometimes.
Sometimes it works great. Actually, that show the other night with art contest show the other night, that's a ton of people who give money at that. That was like, they must have left with a fair bit, which is good. You know, that's awesome.
What do you see in the future for Culture Vulture? Do you have surprising upcoming plans or news?
Well, we have an EP coming out fairly soon, maybe by the end of August, beginning of September. We're looking into releasing that, maybe going on tour. After that, I think we're going to just continue to write. We've been gotten to a point where we're not doing a whole lot of writing at the moment, and you know, I know all three of us are kind of itching to get back, like, into the studio and write more things, just kind of do things differently. And so,
because, like, with this EP, we recorded everything that we have written, so, like, everything that's done is on that EP, so we're at a completely, like, blank place where we're like, okay, now we get, like, to just do whatever on the next effort.
So speaking of writing, what books do you guys think people should read?
Good lord. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
I agree.
I think everybody should read that book.
Which one?
All of them. All of the fucking animations. All of the sequels. Because they're hysterical, and they've got a lot of, like, really good points. Really good points in them.
This is your brain on music?
Yeah.
I would suggest go find a book on neurology and read about it. You know, your brain's fascinating.
Really, really just find a book.
Just read.
But whatever you're interested in, there's 100,000,000,000 fucking books written on that subject, so just find something you're interested in. I'm totally guilty of not reading that, so.
I don't know how to read, so.
Well, that's just from our
tits that are mistakes. Nick, your trombone has a monster of a sound. How did you develop that tone, and where would you want that tone to be, ideally?
I've been playing instruments since I was 8, and I'm old as fuck now, so that's, you know, been a long time that I've been playing instruments, so I just want to have a bunch of different sounds. I get kind of bored hearing the trombone by itself. It's a monophonic instrument, and just like, you could, I don't know, I felt like I hit a wall with it in terms of like keeping myself super interested. And we started adding the effects to it, and that is something I'm still working on. I mean, like, I'll always love the instrument. I like adding all that capability to it.
Matt, how do you feel like going to school for percussion has affected your music career post-graduating?
Well, I think it's certainly helped me out in some ways. I'd been playing drums, I'm 24 now, I've been playing since I was 12, that drum set. And I played snare and percussion, timpani and whatnot, and all through high school. I was on the drum line. And so I never really had a formal drum set lesson until I was maybe my second year of college. They didn't really have a drum set teacher, but my professor gave me this book that was mostly about how to apply rudiments from jazz, swing and whatnot. But before that, I'd never really played anything jazz. So I think that's kind of helped me come up with more interesting parts in a way. But another thing, I think really what I would consider my main influence is just from listening to all that I can. I think there's something that you can't really be taught in school about just coming up with creative ways to play it. Because there is a right and a wrong sometimes, but I think there's kind of a blurred line distinction. So.
What other groups in Savannah have you worked with?
As individuals, I know we've all done a little bit and filled in guitar for a couple bands, Anxiety Junkies, Rolling Gnome.
I play in another band called Doom Salad, so I've been working with those guys for a good while now. I've also did a little drum battle with Magnus of Kyle fame, and that was something.
It happened.
It happened.
Dope Sandwich.
We did a little thing with Dope Sandwich. That was great.
And we've all actually, we function as kind of a jazz band from time to time.
So I've heard from a lot of people, including some of my favorite musicians in Savannah, that Culture Vulture puts on the best live performance. What do you guys have to say about that?
Nope.
Yeah. I don't know who's outside of the castle to answer that.
We work really hard, we still...
Yeah, that's an honor. That's awesome. Thank you. And thank you to all the people who said that. But I mean, it's one of those things you can't really say, who is actually putting on the best show. I mean, it's Crazy Bag, we don't hang from the ceiling like Crazy Bag Lady does, and that drives me wild. I love that shit. I don't know, I go and I see Triathlon, and they're doing their thing, and that works for me. That's a great show, and it just is fantastic. Kyle's got their whole, you are Kyle, we are Kyle,
inclusive.
Yeah, the Kyle community thing. Omi Gnome's got their whole, they've got the props, and they've got, Simon, they've got planetary projections.
Dope Sandwich has the props, too.
Yeah, and Dope Sandwich has got the props. Everybody's got their own thing, and everybody does their own thing very well around here, so I don't think there's anything say is the best, but that's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, Culture Vulture, for joining me at the beam. My beer's done. I think we're gonna go back to the bomb shelter and see what else you guys have for us.
All right, cool. Thank you.
Thank you very much.